So the line between math and physics is something that I, you know, had to think a lot about, because since I want to have this sort of rigorous axiomatization approach, I need to understand how do they do in math and whether the way that they do in math is actually good for physics, if it's enough. And one of the things that we have sort of a wrong impression in physics or in engineering is that math, it seems all so elegant or pristine and so precise. And it feels like that everything is there and we should imitate math in some way. But this is kind of never going to work, because the way that math is able to be rigorous, like the way that they did it, is essentially to remove all the parts that are difficult or impossible to make precise and remain only with the formal structure, the syntactic structure, that you can actually be precise about. So there are sort of a lot of things like, well, they're called semantic paradoxes, like something like...
There's the largest number that can't be described.
Yes. Or
there's the smallest number that can't be described in so-and-so amount of characters.
Exactly, right. So that's something that if you have meaning, right, is meaning is attached. Meaning is always this very fuzzy thing, and it always allows you to create some things like that. And so what I guess the formalists decided, Hilbert, I think, was the one that pushes for this, is say, okay, we'll forget what the meanings are. We just have some symbols. They have some rules. And that's it. That's all that we're going to describe in mathematics. And a lot of mathematics is now thought in that way, in one way or another. And in a sense, that's sort of where the power of math comes from, because if you talk about, I don't know, a Boolean lattice, for example, well, that same structure could be representing sets of statements, so a logical structure, or sets of sets, or it could have, like, physically could even describe the systems and subsystem relationships. So you can study the mathematical structure, you can study the equations, regardless of where they come from, physics, biology, economics. So in the end of the day, to the mathematician, it has an advantage to just drop the meaning, because then their tools are more powerful, because they can be applied regardless of the meaning. And in physics, we can't do that because we have that pesky connection with experiments. And so we can't just manipulate symbols in any way, whatever. We need to know that that symbol corresponds to a specific system prepared in a specific way with the things that we measure, a specific thing. So we always have an informal system in physics. You can't just get rid of it. And so what the challenge is not saying we're going to put everything in the formal system, because it's never going to happen. The experiments are not going to suddenly become symbols. You need to define what is advantageous to put in the formal system and what is not. And that's the hard part. So it's not a question of whether you can do it, but it becomes a technical problem, sort of an engineeristic problem in how can you do it efficiently. Essentially, the game is to find, the minimal set of axioms that you want, that you need, actually, in the form that it's as easily justifiable from the physics. Because that surface, right, that line in between when you take physical, informal things and you put them in the formal things, that's where the things can go wrong. Once you are in the formal system, you have the math to help you. And so those parts, and that's the part that I'm interested in physical mathematics, getting those definitions and justification right, it's the part that is the most difficult. And it's most difficult because I have a feeling, and I can't, I'd like to be able to have a proof for this, but again, you can't, because it ties in things in the informal system, so it's difficult to create a proof for that. I'd like to have a tight argument that shows that whenever you're taking something from the informal system to the formal system, that is my feeling, you are always going to make some kind of simplification. And so even a simple concept like, whether something is an orange or not, right? You go to a supermarket, you can easily identify what is an orange and not an orange. So it seems natural that, that's a true false statement, very easy. But if you think how an orange develops, starts with a flower, gets pollinated, and that, right? And there is no point that you can say, ah, this is the instant where it actually became an orange, right? So all these concepts that we have are fuzzy, and you're going to have to make a cut. And so if you're talking about objects in a supermarket, yeah, perfectly fine, because we're not going to have this in between. And so it's going to be either true or false. But if you're studying biology, you're not going to, that statement is going to be ill-defined. So even defining this property, even defining the statements themselves, I don't think there is a way to define statements that are universally applicable in all circumstances. It's always a matter of, I have a realm of applicability, a domain, and in that domain, in that context, that statement makes sense.
Okay, you just mentioned the word cut, which makes me think of Heisenberg cut, which makes me think of the measurement problem. So I'm curious what you think of the measurement problem. What have you found out? What are your current thoughts?
I don't understand what the measurement problem is, because when I talk to a lot of people, they seem to have a different interpretation. So how would you formulate the measurement problem?
What counts as a measurement?
Uh-huh. That I don't have an answer for. And it's again, one of those things that for me lives in the informal system. And so I don't even know if I can formulate something precise. Right. So you see, this is exactly why I asked, because there is another part that is, why do we have two different laws of evolution, one for measurement and one for processes, that I think can be understood.
Oh, okay. Right?
But what counts as a measurement, that...
What separates a measurer from a measured?
Well, yes. So what I wanted to say is that in this realm, what counts as a measurement, and all of these problems are connected to the problem that I was saying before of defining boundaries between system and environment. Mm-hmm. Because when you're saying, I have a system, I make a measurement, you're basically saying, okay, there is a system, there is a boundary.
Well, let me predict a problem with this, is that if we're saying that, then there's necessarily something subjective, because we're going to be the ones that are dictating the boundary. There's then the meta measurement problem of who is defining the system.
Right. So defining the system is not subjective. It's objective, but it's contextual. Like you need, it's again, in this context, these are the things that can happen. This is what happens at the boundary. So it's not an arbitrary. When I say I have a system and I define a boundary, I'm also defining what is happening at the boundary, right? So it's not just saying, oh, I'm grouping these things together, but I'm grouping this together. There is this interaction between the boundary and the system. Like I need to give you the boundary conditions, not just to solve to define the problem of the equation, but really to be able to define the system, right? And so part of the problem of defining what a measurement is and how it works and all of this is because you are trying to model something that goes across the boundary, which is even just the information that passes from one thing to the other, and then information has to be encoded in some physical system, so something needs to happen. And then in quantum mechanics, there is a thing that actually happens during the measurement. And this is how I think about it. So imagine that you have your block ball for the two-state system, right? You pick an observable, right? Which means you're picking an axis in some direction. And the points at the axis are going to be your eigenstates. Uh-huh. And all the points in the middle are mixtures of those two states, right? So now imagine that you start at any other point, sure, right? And you want to say, oh, I'm going to make a measurement, right? Like none of these, what you're going to be predicting after the measurement is going to be that you're going to be either in this state, yes, or in this state. So you're going to be in this, after the measurement, what you predict is that you're going to be at a point on the axis. So what the measurement process needs to do in one way or the another, whether it's through whatever mechanism, it doesn't really matter. What needs to happen is that that point that is here needs to be projected on that axis. That process is a process that increases entropy.
Right.
And so that's something that needs to happen. And there are a lot of people that from other places argue that measurement devices are things that increase entropy. You have a metastable state that gets perturbed and then falls into two equilibria, right? There is this sense that you have something and you fall into two equilibria. And there are some people that have argued that there is literature that that shows that. But I'm trying to argue it more from a sort of more conceptual, you know, again, from what I need to have to be able to make this make sense. And there's something else that, oh, yes. So I understand that this measurement process is a process that actually increases entropy. It has given me sort of a way to think about these changes of context along the lines of what happens in thermodynamics. So since you studied statistical mechanics and you are happy with that, you know that there are different types of ensemble. There is the grand canonical ensemble, there is canonical ensemble, and so on. And in each of those ensembles, some quantities are the ones used to actually define the ensemble. So if I have a cup of water and it's just sitting there, and I ask you, how many molecules are there in the cup of water? Well, it's a problem because molecules keep going out and coming in, so the molecules are fluctuating, right? And this is the overall macro state is not defined by the number of molecules. It's a grand canonical ensemble. It's going to be defined by temperature, volume, and chemical potential. But now you want to really see and say, I really want to know how many molecules are there. And so you need a way first to stop these molecules from fluctuating, because otherwise you can't even know which one you count and so on. So what you do, you close the glass.
Yes.
And when you close the glass, you transition from a grand canonical ensemble to a canonical ensemble. And now the canonical ensemble has a volume, temperature, and number of particles well-defined. And the chemical potential is no longer well-defined. Now, of course, when you closed it, you can't predict exactly how many molecules are there because the molecules were fluctuating. So the final state is going to be a probability distribution over all the possible canonical ensembles of all the different number of molecules, with the distribution exactly matching the fluctuation that you had before.
Wait, why can't you just say, if you have a cup, you say, how many molecules are in this cup at 2 p.m.? 2:01 p.m. on the dot.
Exactly. You close it at that time.
Yes.
And now you go count.
Yeah. Is that well defined, what I just said?
Yeah. You're closing it.
Like, so do we still need to do some averaging even for a question like that, where we give a specific time?
At specific time, you are going to have the problem that, again, things are going to be fluctuating. How do you go and measure it at that time?
Can you not just close it at that exact instant?
Exactly. So when you're closing it,
yes,
you went from a grand canonical ensemble to a canonical ensemble.
I see.
Like, you switch the thing, is no, the number of molecules are no longer fluctuating. In a way, you can think of process measurements in quantum mechanics doing exactly that. So you have your spin system, right?
But wouldn't that have some hidden variable associated with it?
The hidden variables, you can only define them if you're able to prepare ensembles that are at a finer resolution of what you were able to do, right? So you are able to talk about actual number of particles and so on in those type of ensembles, because you can isolate the molecule and talk about the parts.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.